Hello and welcome to my channel. My name is Behroz. I'm a finance executive by profession and a personal development and growth coach by passion. In this video, I talk about rules for investing and saving. This video is part of a video series on personal finance where I share golden rules on personal finance. For instance, rules for investing, rules for saving, rules for buying a house, rules for buying a car, rules for budgeting and so on and so forth. Now, in case you like the video, please don't shy away from pressing the like button and also subscribe to the channel so you get notified as soon as I put a new content on the channel. Now, let's get moving with the topic. So let's start with talking about rules for saving for financial independence. Now, rule number one is to have specific goals, which should have specific numbers and specific dates. You should not put it off for tomorrow, rather you should do it today. Here, you should make use of the 4% rule to reach financial independence. The idea here is that you should have enough savings so that your first year of expenses are equal to 4% of your total net savings that you have. The 4% rule has been derived from the average return that has been received by investing in S&P for past 100 years. Although the return is around 7 to 10%, however, after adjusting for taxation, inflation and all, you should expect a 4% return if you invest all your savings in the stock market S&P 100. So the idea here is that you should not be diluting or eating from your equity. Rather, your expenses should equal to the interest or the earnings that you can generate by investing that saving, which is around 4%. So now let's use some numbers to explain the 4% rule further. Let's assume you come to a conclusion that your expenses when you are financially independent is around $8,000 per month. $8,000 per month means $96,000 annually, which means you need $2.4 million worth of assets, which is 4% of $2.4 million is $96,000. So if you have $2.4 million worth of assets, that can generate around 7 to 8% return. After tax, after costing for inflation and all, you will get 4% of that $2.4 million, which is $96,000, divided by 12 is $8,000 per month. So rule number two is to save for your retirement first before you save or pay for your kids' education, because retirees don't get scholarship. So your kids may have their whole life in front of them where they can always earn and pay for their college or even get scholarships. However, for you, there is less life left to earn, rather more life left to spend as a retiree. And hence you need to make sure that you prioritize your retirement savings over saving for your kids' education. So rule number three states that time is money. Time is actually the basic form of currency which we exchange in order to earn money. But if we spend all that money, actually we are spending all that time. However, if we save that money, we generate wealth, and wealth is a measure of how much time you can buy in future. So by saving money, you will be able to reach your financial independence because you can then buy your time, because you don't have to exchange time in order to earn more money, rather you own your own time. Rule number four, make sure you get the employer match if you have a retirement program. This is like free money. All you need to do is put in some money in your retirement program and your company tops up some amount or some percentage of that money that you've already added. This is again, as I said, free money and you should never miss on. Rule number five is to pay yourself first. This is a very important rule. Again, comes back to saving, which is you should save first because you are buying hours and times in your future. So it's important to buy that time and hence save first before you can spend or buy the next important thing that you need to buy. Also, saving first versus saving last means that you're more likely to save money versus relying on spending first and then seeing whatever is left that you end up saving. In that case, you would be able to save less or not be able to save at all. Hence, it's important to save first before you go on any spending spree. Also here, note that every time you get a raise, add all your raise to your saving or most of your raise to your saving. Once you've achieved a certain salary that funds a certain lifestyle that you're content with, you don't need to go above that. So when you get a raise, put it into savings versus spending it. This helps avoid the problem of lifestyle inflation, where every time you get a raise, you spend more and consume more and increase your lifestyle, which will not bring more happiness or more contentment with you because you were already happy with the initial lifestyle or the previous lifestyle you had. In this way, you will be able to save more and able to buy more time in future and hence reach financial flexibility earlier. Second is whenever you get a windfall, let's say a bonus, only use 1 to 2% of that bonus to give yourself a treat and save the rest. Again, same principle applies. You don't need to increase your lifestyle just because you got a bonus. Also, more importantly, it's not a raise. It's a one-time windfall. So you'll get it one time, but you won't get it again. So you don't really need to increase your lifestyle in a way where next time if you don't get this bonus, you will not be able to maintain the lifestyle you are having now. So use all these windfall for savings and not spending at all. Now let's talk about the rules of investing. Number one rule is never handpick a stock. Always go for index fund. This is very simple and very effective. People who invest full time are smarter than you. You can't beat them. They have more knowledge, more information, and they are able to make smarter decisions. Given your limited information, don't try to outsmart the market or outsmart the experts. Don't invest in something that you don't know, as Warren Buffett says that you should only invest in things you know of. He's quoted somewhere to say that I don't make profits from something that I don't understand. Hence, try to focus on things that you understand. For me, for instance, I understand that the S&P index for past 50 years has been growing by 7 to 10%. I expect similar returns in the future as well, and most of my investment lands in S&P index. Rule number two is don't do something, just sit there, says Jack Bogle, on how bad it is to worry about your investments and take actions in emotions. This is true for all of those who during the pandemic sold their stocks out of emotion and out of panic. While I saw my stocks in portfolio going down during the pandemic, however, I kept calm and didn't take any action, rather let the market come back up, and now I'm even better than the position I was during the pandemic. Rule number three is sitting on cash is a sin. Cash is good for current expenses and emergencies. However, you should never be sitting on cash. Rather, it should be invested and should be generating more money. You should be generating money out of your cash even when you're sleeping. This is only possible if your cash is invested. Holding on too much cash means that you're losing on long-term value. Rule number four, and one of the most important rule, is always to make sure that you keep your investment cost low. Investment fees and expense ratios can eat up your profits, and make sure that they are as low as possible. I made a mistake of investing in an opportunity which was earning around 10% returns, however had an expense ratio of 2%. So net I was making only 8% as profit. But let's say if I made the same investment in S&P index, which also gives around 10% return as per historic numbers, with an expense ratio of less than 0.5%, in that case I would have been making 9.5% return. So I had a lost opportunity of around 1.5% return just because I was paying higher fee. Rule number five is that rebalancing of your investment portfolio should be part of your investment plan. Portfolios that initially start diversified can soon become concentrated. So let's say if there's an asset which has done extremely well, then that asset will start taking more and more part of your total equity. So let's say you started with 10% investment in that particular asset, but there could be an instant where that asset did extremely well and it ends up becoming 20% of your total portfolio. Now is the time to rebalance your portfolio, because you don't want 20% of your eggs in the same basket, and hence it's important to rebalance based on whatever your diversifying strategy is. Lastly, adjust your risk profile basis your age. So the younger you are, you should be taking more risk because you have more runway to earn and make up for any losses that you will incur. However, as you are aging, you should be more careful with your investments and should rebalance your portfolio in a way where you have some investments which are risky, but then there is portion of investment that is less risky. And as you age, you should move your funds from more risky to less risky portfolio. One way to do that is to have a mix of bonds and equity in your portfolio. The younger you are, the more investments you should have in your equity. And as you age, you should start moving your investment from your equity investments to your bonds. Now, thanks for watching this video. Hope this was helpful. In case you liked the video, please don't shy away from pressing the like button and also subscribe to the channel so you get notified as soon as I put new content on this channel. Thanks for watching.